Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Thank you so much for coming here, and welcome to our panel presentation on climate change and Indigenous resistance. My name is Palmer Legare. I'm a student at Montgomery Community College, and soon I will be introducing you to the rest of our panel, climate scientist David Goodrich, and Mark Charles, who's an activist on Native American and social justice issues. I'd like to start by speaking some about some of my experiences and thoughts working for over 15 years with primarily Indigenous and peasant communities in Guatemala, where I helped start the Guatemala Solidarity Project. We express ourselves through loving nature, loving life, loving humans, loving the past, loving the present, loving the future. I wanted to start with that phrase that is spoken often in some of the communities that we work with, because although I haven't asked either of our other panelists here, I dare say that they are here and I am here because we love life, because we recognize the incredible beauty in life. I often find myself overwhelmed by thinking of how amazing life is. Just for example, the human body, how we can breathe in air, and our heart pumps the oxygen and nutrients through our blood to our tissues, to our organs, and we don't even have to think about it. How I can open my eyes and see so many colors that I can't even describe, and walk outside and look at the beautiful sky, and I feel a love for so many people that I can't describe, and I don't know where it comes from. And life is really just so amazing, and that's why I'm here. But unfortunately, a lot of this beauty that exists is under threat, is under attack. In the case of Guatemala, 500 years ago, the Spanish attacked Guatemala. And they said that they discovered Guatemala because they didn't think of the hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of people who live there as being human beings. And they therefore felt like it was okay to torture, to murder, and to steal land from these people in order to generate profit. And so this was followed by hundreds of years of horrific genocidal violence. And finally, in 1944, there was an amazing revolution in Guatemala where people were able to overthrow the dictator who was armed and supported by the United States government. And they were able to set up, for the first time, democracy, at least elections in Guatemala. And these democratically elected governments made some very common sense reforms where they ended a system of forced labor for the indigenous majority in Guatemala. Now at this time in 1944, before the revolution, the main landowner in Guatemala was the United Fruit Company, a US-based corporation that was led in large part by high-ranking government officials. For example, the Dulles brothers, John and Alan, who were at the time the head of the CIA and the Secretary of State. And today we honor these people, for example, with the naming of Dulles Airport. But these people were profiteers of slavery. And they were not very happy with the changes of the revolution, that they could no longer make the kind of profit that they were able to make from slave labor. And so the United States government worked very aggressively to end democracy in Guatemala, culminating in 1954 when the US Air Force bombed Guatemala, overthrew the democratically elected government, and installed a military dictatorship that, for all real means and purposes, continues to this day. After this overthrow, there was a roughly 40-year-long civil war in which, according to the United Nations and the Catholic Church, the Guatemalan government, with the full support and leadership of the United States government, committed acts of genocide against the indigenous majority in Guatemala. They targeted children, women, men, based solely on the fact that they were indigenous people. In many of our partner communities where I go to, people will say to me, "Look, Palmer, right there, it's a clandestine cemetery where the military came in, they picked up children by the ankles, they would swing them against trees, so when their neck hit the trees, It would snap and they would die. They would then rape and murder children, excuse me, women. If women were pregnant, it was frequent that they would cut open their bodies and tear out the fetuses. They would then force the men in the community to dig trenches, throw in the bodies of their children and wives, and then they would murder these men. This is very recent U.S. and Guatemalan history. And it officially ended in 1996 with the signing of the final peace accords. And because of this, it is no longer common for the military to go into indigenous communities and murder dozens of people. And this is a really good thing, obviously. However, since the signing of the peace accords in 1996, there is now more poverty and more hunger in Guatemala. And it is because, for the most part, multinational corporations are taking advantage of this so-called peace to steal even more land from indigenous communities. And I'm going to show you a video of what I'm talking about. This video was taken roughly 5 years ago. And it's of violent attacks that the Guatemalan government called legal evictions that took place against approximately 15 of our partner communities. The day before these attacks, representatives of these communities were meeting with government officials in negotiations asking that their right to the ancestral lands that they're living on be respected. They thought that the government was negotiating in good faith, but the very next morning, over 1,000 Guatemalan soldiers and military showed up unannounced in these communities and started going house to house, destroying, burning down people's homes. Now these, during these so-called evictions, they killed a young man, Antonio, who I believe had three young children and a wife he left behind. Now again, it's really good that they didn't murder 40 people, but unfortunately there's a sick, twisted kind of moral relativism where the United States government and many so-called experts come in and say, oh, there's great progress in Guatemala. Look, they didn't massacre 40 people, that's progress. No, this is disgusting, this is unacceptable. And by the way, this film, these videos that you're seeing is very difficult to come by. The man, a friend of mine who took most of this video, Jose, was attacked. He was briefly choked. Unfortunately, he was able to hang on to the camera so we can all see this. The Guatemalan government does not want you to see these images because of how powerful they are. Personally, I have documented many attacks against indigenous communities. I've even filmed an arson attack against an indigenous community. However, I was attacked, I was beaten up, detained, held at gunpoint, and my camera was stolen, so I'm unable to show that evidence. But these kind of attacks are common. Like I said, this was 5 years ago. Only in the past month, three of our partner communities have been attacked by over 1,000 soldiers and police. Homes have been burned down, people have been shot, people have been arrested on fraudulent charges. Now you see a lot of corn in the background here, and you see right now that people are walking through the corn. These communities worked very hard to grow this corn, but all this corn was chopped down and destroyed, including also the beans. And this is what the community needs to survive. As a result of these kinds of attacks, the majority of people in our communities are suffering from chronic malnutrition. We've worked with Doctors Without Borders and other medical groups who've come into these communities. They tell us that over 80% of children suffer from chronic malnourishment in our partner communities. This means that even if these kids survive, and by the way, people did starve to death after this specific attack, but the majority of people survive. However, these children are going to face lifelong health consequences of living with chronic malnourishment. Even if later on they're able to get three good meals a day, their bodies will not fully develop. Their brains, their kidneys are not going to fully develop, and they're going to face those consequences as adults. Per personally, because of attacks like this, I have lost count of how many children I have seen starve to death in Guatemala. It's unacceptable. And, you know, you can see these houses that are being destroyed. People are not living with great wealth, okay? They don't have cars, they don't have iPhones, but they were eating enough. They were, in many cases, happy. They were surviving. But after this, they are facing a constant situation of hunger and desperation of how they will make it through the day. In every single one of our partner communities, people are either in prison on fraudulent charges, specifically community leaders, or they face arrest warrants. In prison, these people are facing beatings, denial of food, denial of medicine. And so we have a commitment as an organization to go in and meet with these political prisoners at least once a month. During each visit, we give them $30 in quetzales to do as they please, usually to purchase food. I have a friend, Pablo, who's been in prison for over 5 years. Recently, he went 2 weeks without food in prison. They also force him to clean feces with his bare hands. He is a very good man, a very courageous man, and that's why he's in prison. Rick, if you don't mind passing out a petition there, I have a petition about some of these communities. If you all are interested in adding your name to this petition, we'd appreciate it. If you put your email in the petition, we'll send you 4 email updates a year. I kind of want to wrap up by talking about another person who's become a friend of mine, Aparicio, who is a community leader from one of these places that's been targeted. And some of the leaders of this corporation came to him, approached him, and said to him, you know, we know that you are organizing communities, that you have a lot of people who are listening to you, and we would like to offer you a significant amount of money for you to stop doing this. And he said, no, I'm not going to take your money. And they responded to him, you know, Aparicio, you need to think about your children, because if you keep organizing, if you keep speaking out publicly about what's going to happen, what's happening, you are going to be killed, and your children are going to be left with nothing, with no money. Are you sure you don't want to accept this money? And Aparicio responded, you know what? You're wrong. There's something that I have and that my family has that's a lot more important than your money, and it's called dignity. And we're going to choose to live with dignity. And so I'd like to invite and challenge you all to stand up and also live with dignity, and to challenge me to live with more dignity. There's so much pressure in this society for those of us who are students to move forward, push forward with our careers, and for those of us who are working to look for the next job and always get more money and always get the next big material thing that we need. But I think there's something much more important that, at least in the classes that I've attended, isn't talked about, and that is dignity. And I think that we can stand together, we can unite, and we can end this kind of violence, and we can protect the incredible beauty that exists in this world, because we have a lot more power than we realize by standing together. So thank you for listening to me. And I'm now very pleased to introduce the next speaker. He's the former director of Climate Observation Division for the National Oceanic Atmospheric Administration, or NOAA. He's a former director of the Global Climate Observing System at the World Meteorological Organization in Geneva, Switzerland. He spent 2 years on a NOAA research vessel in the Chesapeake Bay, logging over 150 dives. After retirement in 2011, he rode by bicycle from Delaware to Oregon, talking to groups about climate change along the way. He's writing a book about the ride across Oregon titled A Hole in the Wind. I'm very pleased to introduce to you David Goodrich.
Thanks.
Okay, I wanted to thank Palmer and Montgomery College for the invitation here. I want, this is a bit of a gear shift from something that is at once both global and with an aspect that's very close to home here in Montgomery County. I'll get to at the end. As Palmer was saying, after I finished 30-odd years with NOAA and with the United Nations on climate observations, it was kind of a strange thing, because when I started in the business, this is something, climate change is something of an esoteric scientific issue, and it became more and more just this politicized issue where that it was completely out of the realm of science. And I thought, with sort of my bucket list, I like to ride bikes a long distance, and I thought, I guess I got my inspiration from, there's an old 80s film called Animal House, and there's a line from Animal House that says, "This calls for a stupid and futile gesture on somebody's part, and we're just the guys to do it." So this was my stupid and futile gesture. I thought, oh, I'll just ride to Oregon and talk to people along the way. I do have, Palmer was very kind in the introduction, but my biggest credential before I start, this is a Father's Day card from my daughter in about 1990, just to establish for you that I am a big nerd, okay? And I especially like to put this up because she ended up as a professor up at McGill, so she's a really big nerd, and I guess if there's one take-home message, it's never leave a paper trail. As far as climate change goes, they're just it's supposed to be this grand, complicated issue. It's really not. The idea is that climate change is for real. It's here now. I'll show you some things from going across the country where it kind of jumps right out at you. You'll always have cases where it snowed it snowed last week, or it was a cold year last year, that will always be true. But the increase in global temperatures has been pretty relentless. The things that people do have been largely responsible for the global warming trend, not this next storm or this last drought, although there is a human component to all of them. The idea that this is really controversial among scientists is not the case. This is where I hung out for 40 years. This is not a controversial issue among scientists. The figure of about 97%, that can be pretty well supported and has been. There are some solutions, and you'll hear people say, well, China puts out more emissions than the US, and that's true. China passed the US a few years back, but if you look at per person, per capita, we use roughly five times the amount of carbon dioxide per person as China does. Our issues are transforming from a carbon-based economy and simply using less energy. Not really that complicated. So I turned left out of my driveway in 2011. This is the way across. I always thought that, because it was about 4,200 miles, and it's kind of weird to say 2,000 feet per day, because you're kind of averaging Kansas and the Rockies, so that's a little strange. But I go about 60 miles a day, sometimes camping, sometimes in motels. Two places that I wanted to, in particular, I'll miss Jeffrey City, but talk about the start of the ride at Prime Hook Beach in Delaware, and also a place on the Front Range of the Rockies called Cameron Pass. The start of the ride was very close to this place, Prime Hook Beach, which is a barrier island like thousands of other barrier islands along the Atlantic and Gulf Coast and around the world, where this is maybe a little lower than average. You can see where the high tide line gets to. It's actually quite vulnerable, and you can see it when you look at the next barrier island from Prime Hook. And what you can see from space, this is called Fowler Beach, and it it used to be a beach. There used to be homes on this barrier island. And as storms have come by during the course of years, you can see holes punched through the barrier island. It was used to be a freshwater impoundment behind there. Now it's saltwater, tidal. There's water that moves back and forth through there. And if you go on the ground to Fowler Beach, what you see is you can drive up as far as you can, and then you see a guardrail hanging into space. So you come to realize there used to be a lot more land there, and you can still see some of the old observation towers built during World War II that are out in the water. So this is sea level rise happening now. Happens episodically in big storms, but it is a pretty relentless thing. And this is what's driving it. If you look at, we've got instruments that NOAA keeps out, tide gauge records. If you look all up and down the East Coast, you'll see sea level rising, not uniformly. There's some places where the land is actually sinking more than others, notably the Louisiana Delta. But there's also quite a bit of land subsidence in Chesapeake Bay. They estimate that by 2030, the main road into the Norfolk Naval Station, Hampton Boulevard, is going to be underwater twice a day during high tide. So there's a lot that will be going on. As I said, things happen episodically. In Sandy, this was a picture that was taken about a block from my son's apartment. This is kind of the dad. I was sending him an email. I said, you know, you really kind of have to be comfortable with about a foot of water in your street today. And it ended up being about 2 feet. But these were the cars that got washed into the entrance to a local garage. And you folks have seen a lot of the pictures from Hurricane Sandy. And you say, well, was this climate change? And that's almost a different question, almost the wrong question, because in every storm now, there is some man-made component. There is some piece of this that is driven by humans. We've had storms for a long time, but the storms we are getting are more intense, and we can expect them to become more so. Going across the country, I thought Kansas would be pretty easy. You know, it's flat. Figured it'd be able to go up to 80 miles a day. Kansas comes from the Kansa tribe. There means people of the south wind, and there's a lot of wind in Kansas. It shouldn't be too much of a surprise, but it was to me. I was having days where I was going into 30 mile an hour winds and 105 out.
When I was going across in 2011, it was a big drought. We were also seeing smoke from wildfires in Arizona that you could see first thing in the morning. The picture on the left or on the right is the rig, two bags front and rear, and a tent in the back. And it gets a little lonely. Going into the Front Range of the Rockies, as most of you who've been to the Rockies know, they come straight up out of the plains. This is outside of Fort Collins, Colorado 14, going into Poudre Canyon in Colorado. These were some very kind ladies along the way who said, you know, offered me some water along the way that magically transmuted into margaritas. I was lucky I was close to the campground. I would say that. This is the way up Poudre Canyon, pretty steep, river just raging, moose by the side of the road. Was quite a ride. Took me about 2 days to get to the top. And at the summit, the clouds are real close. There's still, you're still in trees. The summit was at 10,000 feet. This is in June, though there's still a lot of snow. You'll notice I'm in shorts, so it was plenty warm. But once I got to the top, and I sort of had to claw my way to the top, didn't have too much gas left by the time I got there, I started looking around, and what you notice is that you get up high And it's not like the forests are dying, the forests are dead. This gray landscape, we were back there last year, if anything, there are just one or two trees left in the forest. This is the result of this bug down on the side, the mountain pine beetle. Used to be that the mountain pine beetle larvae did not survive the winters when the winters got down to 20, 30 below. That doesn't happen very much in the high altitude forests anymore. And there's been an explosion of the mountain pine beetle. This is not limited to Colorado. This forest loss goes through Wyoming, goes through Montana, Idaho, and well up into British Columbia, about 40 million acres. This is the kind of thing that if it happened in a course of a week or 2 weeks, it would be all over the front pages. You never hear about this in the East. But there are wide swaths of the West that are lost as far as how we knew them. You can see still what they call salvage logging, where people are taking down dead trees. You can see that there is beetle-killed pine firewood that is that's for sale. The real estate ads now say great open views because there are not so many trees anymore. So the gist here is that climate change is not something for my kids or your kids. It's something that's here now. We're feeling it now, and it will be accelerating. There is a man-made component to every heat wave, to every drought, and it's just like asking the question for a baseball player who's been on steroids, who's been juiced, and you ask, was that home run a result of the player taking steroids? And you say, well, maybe a little bit. He probably knew how to hit the ball, but it's not the idea of a guy who hit 20 home runs going to 70 home runs sort of makes you scratch your head. And that's the same thing with climate. We've just basically juiced up the hydrologic cycle. We talk about, will climate change be a catastrophe? We're losing low-lying shoreline now in big storms steadily. That is a thing that is going to be accelerating. Large areas of the Rocky Mountain pine forest are already gone. We don't need to wait for decades for some grand technological solution. In between energy conservation and the vast drop in cost for solar and for wind power, there's a good way to replace this. And also the idea of just keeping fossil fuels in the ground. Lastly, to do. We can each do what we can to conserve energy. I mean, I took the bus here, Rick rode his bike. We can support renewables in terms of rooftop solar and expanded wind, but our personal actions are nowhere near enough. What we need to do is to work towards a fossil-free society. We basically need to keep about 80% of the fossil fuels that have been discovered in the ground. If we pump out and dig out everything we've got and burn it, this will become even more uncontrollable than it is. It can't be respectable to own investments in fossil fuels. That is a way that we can stop, that we can help slow this down. Here in Montgomery County, there is a bill that has been introduced before the county council to divest the county's holdings in fossil fuels. There is a public hearing on coming up on December 6th. I'll be testifying. I would encourage, if you can show up, to show up. This is, we can pretty well guarantee that the federal government is not going to do anything about climate change over the next 4 years. It's up to us. You can also email your county council member. We're right on the margin of getting this passed. Might happen, might not. things that we do here now can make a difference. I'd also mention to you that my friend Rick Sullivan has a stack of cards that you can write to your county council members. We each have five, and to fill them out, let people know that we don't want our investments to be part of this fossil fuels. Anyway, thanks.
Thank you very much. We are very fortunate to have our next panelist. He is a dynamic and thought-provoking public speaker, writer, and consultant, the son of an American woman of Dutch heritage and a Navajo man. He speaks with insight into the complexities of American history regarding race, culture, and faith in order to help forge a path of healing and conciliation for the nation. He serves as the Washington, D.C. correspondent and regular columnist for Native News Online and is the author of the popular blog Reflections from the Hogan. Please welcome Mark Charles.
Yat A. Mark Charles Yanishia. Sin Bake Dinan Nishlin, Dotohiglini Bachachin. Sin Bake Dinan Bachache, Dotochini Bachanella. In the Navajo tradition, when you introduce yourself, you always give your four clans. We're a matrilineal society, and so our identities come from our mother's mother. So my mother's mother is actually American of Dutch heritage. And so when I introduce myself, I say Tsin Bake Dene'e, which translated means the wooden shoe people. My father's mother, my second clan, is Toa Higlini, which is the waters that flow together. My third clan, my mother's father, is also Tsin Bake Dene'e. And my fourth clan, my father's father, is Totochitni, which is the Bitterwater clan, one of the original clans of our Navajo tribe. I want to speak to you. Well, first, before we get started, I actually want to honor the Lenape, the Piscataway, the Shawnee tribes. These are the three of the tribes that were in Maryland before it was settled. These are three of the tribes that were ethnically cleansed from this land. And I want to honor their stewarding this land for many, many, many years before they were removed from this area. My father, about 7 or 8 years ago, he served on a committee looking at global warming, climate change, for an organization that was predominantly white American from the dominant culture. And after about a few days of their first few committee meetings, he said to the people in the meeting, he said, well, the reason this nation has so much trouble with caring for this world is because they have a doctrine of discovery. And his other committee members looked at him and said, what are you talking about? And he said, you don't know what it is? Well, Google it, look it up. So they looked it up. And who here has heard of the doctrine of discovery? So the Doctrine of Discovery is a series of papal bulls. The first one was written in 1452 by Pope Nicholas V. It says things like invade, search out, capture, vanquish, and subdue all Saracens and pagans whatsoever. Reduce their persons to perpetual slavery. Convert them to his and their use and profit. The Doctrine of Discovery is the series of papal bulls written between 1452 and 1493 that essentially is the church in Europe saying to the nations of Europe, wherever you go, whatever lands you find not ruled by Christian rulers, those people are less than human and the land's yours for the taking. This was literally the doctrine that allowed European nations to go into Africa, colonize the continent, and enslave the African people because they weren't human. This is the same doctrine that let Columbus, who was lost at sea, land in this new world already inhabited by millions and claim to have discovered it. If you think about it, you cannot discover lands already inhabited. If you don't believe me, leave your cell phones, your car keys in front of you. I'll come by and discover them for you. That's not discovery, that's stealing. The fact that to this day we refer to what Christopher Columbus did as discovery reveals the implicit racial bias of the nation, which is indigenous peoples are not fully human. This, of course, makes our doctrine of discovery a systemically racist doctrine that assumes the dehumanization of indigenous peoples. Now, in 1763, King George drew a line down the Appalachian Mountains, and he essentially said to the colonists that they no longer had the right of discovery of the empty Indian lands west of Appalachia. This upset the colonists. So a few years later, they wrote a letter of protest. In their letter, they accused the king of raising the conditions of new appropriations of land. They went on in their letter to state that he has excited domestic insurrections amongst us and has endeavored to bring on the inhabitants of our frontiers, the merciless Indian savages. They signed their letter on July 4th, 1776. Literally 30 lines below the statement, "All men are created equal," the Declaration of Independence refers to natives as merciless Indian savages, making it very clear the only reason our founding fathers used such inclusive terms like "all men" is because they had a very narrow definition of who was and who was not human. This, of course, makes our Declaration of Independence a racist document that assumes the dehumanization of indigenous peoples and people of color. Now, a few years later, our founding fathers wrote another document. They began this document with the words, "We the people." Of course, this is the preamble to the Constitution. However, Article 1, Section 2 of this Constitution, the section that says who is and who is not included, who is and who is not covered by this Constitution, A, it never mentions women, B, it specifically excludes natives, and three, it counts Africans as three-fifths of a person. So literally, "we the people" means white landowning men. We have to wrap our heads around that. The purpose of the Constitution is to protect white landowning men. So today, women earn 70 cents to the dollar. That shouldn't surprise us. The Constitution's working. Today, our prisons are filled with people of color. This should not shock us. The Constitution's working. In 2010, the United States Supreme Court sided with Citizens United and stated that corporations now have the same rights to individual political speech or to political free speech as individuals do. We should not be shocked. The Constitution is doing exactly what it was designed to do. It is protecting the interests of white landowning men. Now, maybe you're thinking, wait, didn't we correct that? Well, a few years later, we passed the 14th Amendment, 1868. The 14th Amendment was meant to address Article 1, Section 2. It extended the right of citizenship to anyone born on this continent under the jurisdiction of the government. However, it did not give women the right to vote. They were still excluded. It did not give natives the right to vote. We weren't citizens yet. And even after we became citizens in 1924, we didn't get the right to vote in the Southwest till 1948. Women didn't become get the right to vote until women's suffrage in 1920. We forget that Jim Crow laws were written after the 14th Amendment. And in 1970, the U.S. Supreme Court used the 14th Amendment in Roe versus Wade, which now concluded unborn babies aren't human, and therefore they can be aborted. What this demonstrates is that the heart of our Constitution is not a value for life. The value is for exploitation and profit, and the assumption is dehumanization. The practice is dehumanization. This makes our Constitution a racist document that assumes the white landowning male has the authority to determine who is and who is not human. Now, in 1823, we had a Supreme Court case. This is Johnson versus McIntosh. Two men of European descent, they're litigating over a single piece of land. One of them got the land from a native tribe, the other one got the land from the government. They want to know who owned it. The case goes all the way to the Supreme Court. The court had to decide on the principle that land titles were based. They determined the principle was discovery that gave title to the government, by whose subject or by whose authority it was made against all other European governments, and title might be consummated by possession. They went on to use the doctrine of discovery to determine that natives who were here first but are less than human, we only have the right of occupancy to land, like a fish occupies water or a bird occupies air, and Europeans had the right of discovery to the land and therefore the true title to it. This case, along with a few others during the Marshall Court era, created our legal precedent for land titles. Now, this precedent and the doctrine of discovery were referenced by the Supreme Court as recently as 2005. This, of course, makes our Supreme Court a racist court. that to this day has legal precedent based on the dehumanization of people of color. So now that we have a racist doctrine of discovery, a racist declaration of independence, a racist constitution, and a racist Supreme Court, we have a bunch of history we don't know about. I want you to think about the 19th century. This is the century our history books refer to as the century of expansion. We added 30 new states to the Union during this century. About a year ago, I did some research, and I took every year, 1775 to 2016. Every year in blue for our United States is a year that we were in a declared state of war or armed military conflict against another nation or entity. Every year in red is every year we were fighting Native tribes. If you look at the 19th century, 1811 to 1886, we have almost 75 years straight of armed military conflict against Native peoples. These wars down here are just the wars we fought during the 19th century. Clearly, this was not a century of expansion. This was a century of ethnic cleansing and genocide. It was during this century we had the Indian Removal Act that resulted in the Trail of Tears for the Cherokee, the Chickasaw, the Choctaw. We had the Long Walk for the Navajo. We had the Sand Creek Massacre. We had the start of Indian boarding schools. We had the Dawes Act that reduced Native landholdings by two-thirds. We had the massacre at Wounded Knee, 350 Native warriors killed in a single day, 20 Congressional Medals of Honor given to the U.S. soldiers who participated. We don't teach a history of America, we teach a mythology. Instead of dehumanization, we say discovery. Instead of racial hierarchy, we say equality. Instead of ethnic cleansing, we say expansion. Instead of genocide, we say exceptionalism. And we don't like to talk about the fact that our liberty and justice we love to trump is all about white landowning men. Now, right now, there's some indigenous resistance going on. You probably heard of what's going on at Standing Rock. Well, we have to understand what is actually taking place at Standing Rock. You saw that slide I had at the very beginning, where just a few weeks ago, or this was actually in the paper yesterday, or over the weekend, 33 anti-pipeline protesters were arrested and charged with criminal trespass after about 100 of them formed a prayer circle inside a Bismarck Mall. We have the armed, the militarization of the police force around this compound of Native peoples who are there to pray and to have ceremony and to protest peacefully. Now, why is this happening? Well, there's something we have to understand that I want to go through right here. So who's heard of post-traumatic stress disorder? This is an individual diagnosis for a person who's received or experienced violence. Now, there's another trauma called historical trauma. Historical trauma, it's not an individual diagnosis, it's how you understand the broader dissatisfaction in a community. So you don't have this person has historical trauma, it's how you understand why this community is largely dissatisfied with what's going on in its reality. I actually refer to historical trauma as a multi-generational, because it's been proven to be multi-generational, passed down generation to generation. Historical trauma is a multi-generational communal manifestation of PTSD. Does that make sense? Oftentimes it's used to refer to the dissatisfaction in Native and African American communities. When you understand the doctrine of discovery, you can see how our historical trauma comes out of this history of dehumanization by our nation. However, there's another trauma I want to talk about. This is being researched right now. There's a researcher named Rachel McNair who's looking into this, and she's talking about perpetration-induced traumatic stress, or PITS. Perpetration-induced traumatic stress is like PTSD in every way, shape, and form, except instead of afflicting the person who received the violence, PITS afflicts the person who caused the violence. It actually came out of a fairly comprehensive study on Vietnam vets, and it comes from this quote by Socrates, who says, "The doer of injustice is more miserable than the sufferer." So I'm hypothesizing if PTSD has a multi-generational communal manifestation called historical trauma, then pits must also have a multi-generational communal manifestation, and I'm calling that the trauma of white America, because you cannot build a nation on 500 years of dehumanizing injustice without traumatizing yourself. So I identify white America as another group of traumatized people. Now, one of the first symptoms of trauma is shock and denial. So if you understand white America as a people group, as traumatized, it's easy to see their shock and denial. In 2009, Congress buried an apology to Native peoples in an appropriations bill, never spoke of it publicly. That's not racism, that's trauma. Texas and Oklahoma passing laws you can only teach patriotic history. That's not racism, that's trauma. They're so overwhelmed by what they did to become who they are, they can't even teach it anymore. American exceptionalism, which is a coping mechanism for a nation in deep denial of its genocidal past and its current racist reality. Now, if you understand white America as a traumatized group of people, you can see these symptoms, but when you deal with trauma patients, you deal with what are called triggers. A trigger is something that takes you out of reality and into the chaos of the moment of when the trauma happened. A sight, a sound, a smell, something takes you out of reality and back into the chaos of the moment of when the trigger happened. So if we understand white America as a traumatized group of people, it's easy to see their triggers. So 2 terms of a black president is a trigger. Without President Obama in term for 8 years, we never get Donald Trump. It doesn't happen. Any sort of national dialogue on gun control is a trigger. White America can't have this conversation without screaming at each other. I identify ISIS as a trigger. Why is ISIS a trigger? Well, it's a group of religious zealots ethnically cleansing a land to set up their own pseudo-religious empire. This is why Paris gets bombed and white America makes it all about them. We don't know what to do with that. The reflection is so overwhelming. The protest at the Dakota Access Pipeline is a trigger. When you have a society built on the extermination of an entire group of people, when the remnants of those people join together in solidarity to protest, to pray, to have ceremony. That's terrifying. That's terrifying for white America. This sort of sight is what triggers this sight. We don't know what to do with it. We have to deal with the fact that the United States of America is a deeply, deeply traumatized group of people. They're not victims, they're traumatized. We have to treat white America as a group of traumatized people. I often tell people, as I've tried to articulate how it feels to be Native and live on the reservation, I've said for years now that living on the reservation as a Native here in the U.S., it feels like our Native communities are this old grandmother who has a very large and very beautiful house. And years ago, some people came into our house and they locked us upstairs in the bedroom. Today, our house is full of people. They're sitting on our furniture. They're eating our food. They're having a party inside our house. They've since come upstairs and they've unlocked the door to our bedroom, but it's much later. We're tired, we're old, we're weak, and we're sick, so we can't or we don't come out. But the thing that hurts us the most, the thing that hurts our Native communities the most, is that virtually nobody from this party ever comes upstairs, seeks out the grandmother in the bedroom, sits down next to her on the bed, takes her hand, and simply says, thank you. Thank you for letting us be in your house. There's an Aboriginal leader out of Canada who says, where common memory is lacking, where people do not share in the same past, there can be no real community. Where communities to be formed, common memory must first be created. I think this quote gets to the heart of our nation's problem with race, which is we don't have a common memory. We have a dominant white culture that remembers a history of discovery, opportunity, exceptionalism, expansion, and we have communities of color that have the lived experience of broken treaties, stolen lands, slavery, ethnic cleansing, segregation, Jim Crow laws, internment camps, boarding schools, all these other things. We have no common memory. This is why we struggle so hard to have community here. So if we want to have this community, we have to find a way to create this common memory. If we want to understand why our nation does the things it does, we have to understand the doctrine of discovery. I have a good friend, a friend and an author, his name is Steve Newcomb. He refers to the doctrine of discovery as a doctrine of dominance. It's a doctrine that essentially takes the white European Christian male and puts him at the center, and everything else is for their exploitation and profit. Everything else is a resource. So if we have a history of how our nation treated people here in the U.S., the indigenous and other communities of color, we heard about what they did in Guatemala, it should not surprise us what we're doing to our environment. This shouldn't shock us. This is what we do. We have to understand our past. We have to break through this mythology that we teach and actually start teaching our history. One of the problems with the United States of America is we've never lost a war that matters. So we've never had to turn around and, under the scorn of the globe, look back and say, oh, we probably shouldn't have done that. We've never had to look back at our mistakes and learn from them. After World War II, Germany started teaching the Holocaust. China, or Japan, demilitarized. What did we do after we dropped bombs on tens of thousands of people, destroying them in an instant? We ramped up our nuclear arsenal. We've never lost a war that matters. We've never had to look back under the scorn of the globe and say we probably shouldn't have done that. And as a result, we continue plowing forward in arrogance. I often tell people the United States of America is a nation that desperately needs to be adopted. It's a group of 300 million undocumented immigrants, people who've left their homes, left their lands, left everything they've known and understood, and they've come here largely pursuing a financial dream of prosperity. However, they've never asked for, nor have they ever been permission to be here. They have no idea why the mountains lie where they lie. They have no idea why the rivers flow where they flow. As a result, they live here like someone lives in a hotel room. Our indigenous peoples, our creation stories take place here. They tell us why that mountain sets over there. They tell us why that river flows over there. And they teach us, they train us, they exhort us to live here sustainably. Our indigenous peoples need to step up and resume our role as the host people of the land, and that's what we're doing in North Dakota. We are telling this nation, you can't drink oil. Water is life. If you continue to put your economic interests ahead of your environment, soon you will have nowhere to live. We have to find a way to deal with our history. We have to teach our past for what it is, and we have to look at our mistakes and find a way to move forward. We have to create this common memory, because if we don't, we're going to end up destroying ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I'd like to now open up the floor for any comments or any questions that people have in the audience.
Go ahead, now on the spot.
I've been asked to repeat the questions for people on MCTV, but just to shorten it, there's a question about how I got involved in Guatemala, and then there's a question for Mark Charles related to his analogy of a grandmother living the house and asking for apology as opposed to saying thank you. I have sometimes a difficult time answering, saying how I got involved in or why I got involved in Guatemala. I'll try to explain it, but sometimes it's sort of, it's almost like someone asking me, well, why do you breathe? And it's just sort of, that's the way that life has developed for me, and that's the way a lot of many things have directed me. Maybe just two things to mention. One is that I was very lucky to grow up on a beautiful, just a gorgeous vegetable farm in Vermont. That's where our family made our income, and more and more, for whatever reason, people who lived, who were born in the area, did not want to work on the farm, and more the people who worked on the farm were migrant laborers. And I was basically an only child growing up. My brother and sister are much older than I, so my best friends growing up were migrant laborers, some of them from Guatemala, who told me these stories that didn't make any sense to me about people starving. How on earth, I see how intelligent you are, I see what a hard worker you are, you can grow food. How on earth could people be starving? That makes no sense. And so as soon as I turned 18, basically I went to Guatemala to find out firsthand. The other piece of that is, as I wanted to educate myself about the situation, I became more and more familiar with U.S. oppression, and particularly the United States Army School of the Americas, which, if you're interested in learning more about, you can visit SOAW.org. It's a U.S. military training base here in the United States that trains specifically people from countries in Latin America to repress their own civilian populations. In 2000, I went to a protest against the school and participated in nonviolent civil disobedience. I knew that there was some risk in doing so, but I didn't really expect any repercussions. I ended up being sentenced to 3 months in prison and went to jail, to a federal prison, because of this action. And that also inspired me to want to find out, you know, why is the government so concerned about intimidating us who oppose this school? And so again, when I started going to Guatemala, I met people and I started making commitments, and I certainly keep going back because I have seen that our actions as an organization can make a great impact. But much, much, much more than that, I am inspired incredibly by the people of Guatemala, who I really relate to some of what Mark Charles was saying, that we don't really have origin stories based on the United States. And people in Guatemala, I found, value the reality around them a lot more than some of the folks here. And I have a lot of joy in spending time with people down there. And I actually have much more difficulty coming back to the United States from Guatemala and adjusting to lifestyles of people here in the United States than I do going to Guatemala and adjusting to different realities down there.
The reason I use this metaphor of the grandmother in the house is because our nation is nowhere near ready to apologize. In December 19 of 2009, President Obama signed House Resolution 3326, which was the 2010 Department of Defense Appropriations Act, a 67-page bill laying out the appropriations for the DOD for 2010. Page 45, subsection 8113, is titled Apology to Native Peoples of the United States. What follows is a 7-bullet-point apology. It mentions no specific tribe, no specific treaty, and no specific injustice. It basically says, you had some nice land. Our citizens didn't take it very politely. Let's just now call it all of our land and steward it together. The apology then ends with a disclaimer saying nothing in here is legally binding. To date, this apology has not been announced, read, or publicized by the White House or by Congress. The United States is nowhere near ready to apologize. It doesn't even know what it's done wrong. People don't even know their history. We teach this mythology. We don't teach American history. And so people don't even know what they're apologizing for. So about 12 years ago, I moved with my family from Denver, Colorado, back to the Navajo Reservation, and we lived in a remote sheep camp, 6 miles off the nearest paved road on a dirt road. We lived with a family. We were in a one-room hogan, about 20 feet wide, dirt floor, log walls, no running water, no electricity. The family we lived with, they wove rugs and herded sheep for a living. And while I was there, the thing that, I mean, we prepared ourselves to live off the grid, but the thing that completely took me by shock was I literally felt like I dropped off the face of the earth. We quickly learned that the only non-natives who come to Indian reservations are those who come to take our picture, are those who come to give us charity. Nobody comes for the purpose of just building a relationship and getting to know us. We never get campaigned to, we never get talked to, we're not a part of the media, the news cycle, or anything. And it was while I was there, I was experiencing the historical trauma of my people and looking at the oppression and the marginalization of our nation. And I was trying to find a way to talk about these things, and I would talk and write and email with my non-Native friends, and every time I would start talking about this history, I would find myself getting angrier and angrier and angrier and angrier. And soon I would have to drop out of the dialogue because I wanted to start screaming. So then I learned how to temper myself and disconnect emotionally. And then I find I could stay in the dialogue longer. But once I did that, I saw the defenses of my friends begin going up. That wasn't my family who did those things. We didn't do that. We didn't steal your land. And soon they would drop out of the conversation because they were so defensive. So it was out of this trying to find a way to talk about this with my friends that I wrote this metaphor. After I spoke that, I wrote that metaphor for the first time, like, that's it, that's exactly how I feel. I started sharing that metaphor, and other natives would come up to me and say, I've lived on the reservation all my life, I've never been able to articulate how I felt, and you just hit the nail on the head. I would have non-natives come up to me and say, what does it mean to say thank you? Now we're having a very different dialogue. Now instead of pointing fingers, addressing and worrying about liability, now we're having conversation about this reversal of roles that's taken place. Which we have, this reversal of roles is we have 300 million undocumented immigrants running around like they own the place. And we have 6 million indigenous peoples of this land living upstairs in the bedroom, acting like unwanted guests in someone else's house. We have to reverse those roles. If I start the dialogue with pointing a finger, and I start talking about reparations and justice, immediately that draws a line in the sand. We have one group that wants to maximize their payout, and the other group that wants to minimize their liability, and we predetermine the only place we can have this conversation is in the courts. Which doesn't believe my people are human. Why in the world would I ever want to have this dialogue in the courts? The Constitution was not written to give my people justice. That's not the purpose of the Constitution. The Supreme Court is not there to give justice to my people. That's not the purpose of the Supreme Court. Why would I want to have this conversation in the courts? So I'm working to try and frame the dialogue in a place that talks about our roles instead of our liability, because we can't start the conversation there. Eventually we have to get to that point, but we have to find a better way to start the dialogue, and having the dialogue in the courts is not the place to have it. This dialogue will go nowhere if we try to have it in the courts. So I've been using that metaphor for 8 years now, inviting people into this conversation about our reversal of roles. And it has been the most beneficial tool I've had, probably, to invite our nation into a conversation about our history. That's a great question. Thank you for asking that. So the first question is, if we are identifying white America as a traumatized group of people, the metaphor of PTSD has a multi-generational communal manifestation of historical trauma, and then PITS must also have a multi-generational communal manifestation that I'm calling the trauma of white America. Your question is, how do we engage white America with that?
How do we engage white America, and how do we move forward out of the shock and denial?
Yes, how do we move through the shock and denial phase? So the things that I am working with in regards to that is our nation is definitely in the place of shock and denial. That's where it is. Now, I have a full presentation I give. It's about 40 to 50 minutes long. And in that presentation, I lay out this trauma piece. But what I'm trying to do, I'm actually not running around the nation trying to convince white America they're traumatized. That's not my goal. I'm trying to treat them as traumatized and convince people of color that white America is traumatized. Because as people of color, when we go back to our communities, we know we're jacked up. We know our reservations, our inner cities have problems. We know our people have issues we're dealing with. The problem is we tend to think white America came out of this history unscathed. And because of that, we look to white America like they can fix it. White America can't fix it. What does white America as an entity bring to the table to fix it? Well, first they bring their money, which is all blood money. It's not gonna fix it. Second, they bring their understandings of liberty, justice, equality, and freedom, which their own documents state exist only for them. That's not gonna fix it. Now, if you have a 7-year-old daughter, 6-year-old daughter or son, they have the capability to go into your car, pull the parking brake, either accidentally or on purpose, let it roll down the hill and hit a tree. They have the ability to smash your car. They can't fix it. Screaming at them to fix it only frustrates you and paralyzes them. Can they be involved in the process of fixing the car in a way that communicates you shouldn't do this? Absolutely. But can they be put in charge of fixing the car? Absolutely not. White America is in a place of shock and denial. They cannot fix it. They cannot lead the conversation. They have to be involved, but they cannot lead the dialogue. And so I am working hard to convince people of color that white America is traumatized so we can treat them that way. Because it's creating this common memory, it's teaching this history. It's removing the mythology and teaching the history. That is one of the triggers for white America. Now, one of the reasons I use the word trauma is because in most racial dialogues, white America is either racist or they're fragile. Neither of those I find helpful. If white America is racist, if you're racist just because you're white, there's no room in the conversation for you. If white America is fragile, it means I have to walk on eggshells around you. By understanding white America is traumatized, when they start to react to a trigger, I can filter it through. They're not screaming at me. They're screaming at the mythology is breaking down around them, and that's upsetting them. I can filter it through that. And so I can, this is good. We're making a connection. This is a healthy response. You should be upset. I mean, you're making an emotional connection, this is good. But at the end of the hour, it's like, okay, we're done. You know, you're not gonna ruin my lunch. I'm not gonna let you take over my whole day. I'm not gonna let you ruin my life. Okay, we'll come back next week, we'll pick up where we left off. Treating white America as traumatized. Treating them as a patient who, when you're in the shock and denial stage as a patient, you need a therapist who's walked down that road before. I'm not saying people of color are any better, but we've been walking down that road. We've been aware of our trauma much longer than white America has been. And so I'm trying to train people of color, communities of color, almost as therapists for white America, so we know how to respond. We don't play into their triggers. We don't. You know, rarely do you go into a therapy session or a counseling session and the counselor starts mixing it up with the patient. No, the counselor knows what's going on. They know what's going on for them. So they give them room to express themselves, but then they also know how to take control of the situation. So creating this common memory is going to cause white America to trigger. that's going to cause these reactions because we don't know what to do with this history. So then the question of what do we do, where if the courts are not the place to have this dialogue, many nations have had what are called truth and reconciliation commissions. National dialogues about their past, about their history, where the truth is taught, the truth is revealed, and there's a way forward that's found. So in South Africa, they had a truth and reconciliation commission after the fall of apartheid. This commission resulted actually in writing a new constitution. In Rwanda, at the end of this bloody civil war, they had a truth and reconciliation commission where both sides were allowed to talk and air. In Canada, just a few years ago, they had a TRC in response to a lawsuit brought by residential school survivors against the churches and the government. I'm advocating we need something like that in this nation. And so I've been advocating for a few years, and what I call it is we need a national truth and conciliation commission. So I don't use reconciliation because the context for the dialogue is race. And you probably heard the term racial reconciliation before. It's used in a lot of social justice circles. Well, that word's a misnomer. A, race is primarily, it's not a genetic difference. It's a human construct. And in America, race was constructed for the purpose of oppressing and dividing. The black race was constructed partially using the one drop rule. If you have a single drop of African blood, you're black. Why do we have this rule? Well, they're the slaves. We want as many of them as possible. The one drop rule lets a white slave owner rape his female slave and produce more baby slaves. That's how we constructed the black race. For natives, we have the blood quantum rule. You're full, you're half, you're quarter, you're 16th, you're 32nd, then you're bred out of existence. Why do we have this rule? Well, the myth of America is this land was empty. So we want to reduce our number of Native peoples. So we have the blood quantum. So race was constructed in the U.S. for the purpose of oppressing and dividing. Reconciliation implies a previous harmony. Clearly that never existed here. Racial reconciliation merely lets us perpetuate the myth of America. Things were once great here, now they're not. Racial conciliation is merely the mediation of a dispute. Reconciliation perpetuates the myth. Conciliation allows, almost demands, a much more honest starting point. So I'm advocating we need a national truth and conciliation commission in regards to race. And I'm working towards one. I think we have to have one sooner rather than later. I'm actually working towards one in 2021. And on my website, I've written more about this. I have some videos up there that talk more about this, but I'm working towards a Truth and Conciliation Commission in the year 2021. And you can find, there's actually a video on my website, which is, if you can scroll down two pages on there. A few more, keep going down. More, there. So wirelesshogan.com is my website. There's actually a presentation I gave at Franklin and Marshall College in Lancaster about 2 months ago, and the second half of that presentation lays out my vision for this Truth and Conciliation Commission, and you can find it there on my website, the link to that video.
So I'm going to maybe try to summarize those two questions, or at least just say for those on MCTV, there was a question for us to expand a little bit on the connection between racial and environmental justice, and then there's a question about what is the role for those of us who are here and maybe wanting to take action on these, what is our role? And I'm gonna ask folks to maybe we can answer those questions and also make our concluding remarks as we bring this event to a close. And before I pass on the microphone, I wanna thank everyone once again for being here. Rick, there's another clipboard there with a yellow paper that I'll invite people to write their contact information on if they want to be informed of more events that this organization puts together. I want to remind people also that we have these postcards. If you're a resident at Montgomery County, you can sign up to 5 postcards trying to support the divestment bill. For those who have not signed it yet, there's a petition going on around related to solidarity with indigenous communities in Guatemala. And Rick, I'd also invite you to pass out the binder there that has some more information, as well as the clipboard. There's more information about the Guatemala Solidarity Project if you're interested in getting more involved.
So in regards to the connection between the race and environment, I would actually say the connection is the doctrine of discovery. And that's what we have to understand. I mean, I showed you just the way it's influenced three of our founding documents, our Declaration, our Constitution, and our Supreme Court. And this is, I mean, we've been talking about black and white issues for most of our history. We've never talked about the doctrine of discovery. It's the same doctrine that allowed America to Europeans to enslave Africans as well as to discover indigenous peoples, but somehow we've never talked about it. And so this is where I'm saying we have to find a way to bring this into the public dialogue. We have to find a way to talk about this. It's this understanding that comes out of this doctrine that is what influences our foundations. It's what's led to our problems with race, and it's what is beneath our understanding of how we treat the environment. And so there's actually a lot of books out there. There's a really good one. It's a thick read, but it's called Pagans in the Promised Land. It's by an author named Steve Newcomb. He's a native author. And he looks at a lot of the ways this doctrine has influenced our legal system. Pagans in the Promised Land. The author is Stephen Newcomb. And then I'm actually writing a book myself right now. It hopefully will be published on Columbus Day next year. The title of this, but the working title we have right now is Truth Be Told. And it actually is more of some of the, it's being published through a Christian publisher, and it's looking at the way the doctrine of discovery has influenced so much of the theology of the nation. If you think the United States has a separation between church and state, you're deceived. We have a deep theology of our nation that comes out of the Roman Catholic Church and the churches in Europe, and it's heavily influenced by the doctrine of discovery. And so this is what this book is going to be addressing, how the theology of the nation has been influenced by this doctrine and what we need to do to address it. I forget the second question here.
What can we do?
Okay. Yeah, so what? So for myself, I'm actually traveling all around the country right now. And I'm speaking, I'm writing, I'm trying to get people to understand this history of the doctrine of discovery. And like I said, I'm working towards, I think we need to do something sooner rather than later. And so I'm working, I would love to see a Truth and Conciliation Commission as early as 2021. Mm-hmm. So on my website, there are ways that you can follow me, read what I'm doing, and understand more of how I'm trying to get this commission started. And then you're welcome to connect with me through any of the social media or through, there's a newsletter, our email address is on my website that you can use as well.
I had part of several questions, specifically with respect to Standing Rock and some of the other activities.
Yeah. Yeah, so Standing Rock, the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe gave a public call to anyone to come and stand in solidarity with them. If you go to Standing Rock, to one of these two camps, you will be welcomed in. These camps are actually fairly diverse. But it's being led by the indigenous peoples, by native tribes, and the elders are actually very highly respected. And the commitment is to nonviolence. The commitment is to prayer and ceremony. So any sort of protest they do is very intentionally talked through, thought through, planned out, and they have very specific purposes behind what they're doing, and it is always with an emphasis on peaceful protest. Now, you can't control thousands of people, and so things sometimes go the ways the elders don't want them to go, but that's what they're working towards. And so now the challenge is last Friday, the Army Corps of Engineers said that they were going to begin removing people from the largest camp beginning a week from today. They say they're doing it for the safety of the people because winter's coming on and blah, 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 blah. But that's, so there's kind of a line drawn in the sand now. Everything I've heard out of the tribe is that they are committed to staying there, and they are committed to protesting this and making sure this pipeline does not get built and does not cross their river. And so next Monday, it's going to be very interesting to see what's going to happen. I already know of a lot of people talking about going there. If you search the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe online and go to their website, there's places on their website you can donate financially. If you're able to go there in person and just stand in solidarity with people, that is highly welcomed and received very well for people to go there and stand in solidarity with the protesters there. Yes?
I read a really interesting article yesterday about the outside law enforcement agencies that are coming into Standing Rock to reinforce the locals there. And these are sheriff's departments, and sheriffs tend to be elected officials. Sort of interesting. But some of the sheriffs, like this one from Montana, was being quoted as saying that he was getting pushback from all over the world.
Yeah.
He was getting phone calls from Poland, Ireland, Germany, as well as all over the states, from people who were dissatisfied with his sheriff's department coming from Montana to reinforce the law enforcement at Standing Rock. And so they're getting these, and there's a lot of these, there's sheriff's departments from Louisiana and all kinds of other states near the North Dakota.
Mm.
And they're not used to this type of scrutiny. So it's something that people can do to tell these law enforcement agencies that,
yeah,
we don't want them there.
Yeah, I'll let
just my final remark is, you know, in from the climate perspective, it is certainly a global problem. Everyone seems to point to everybody else and saying, oh, well, you ought to be doing something. We can do something in Montgomery County here on December 6th. We can get Montgomery County out of this business. People see that there is a future of where a Miami Beach doesn't exist anymore, and an Atlantic City does not exist anymore. And by investing in fossil fuels, not only are you saying, well, that's the way, just the way it's gonna be, but we need a piece of that future. We can turn that down here on starting on December 6th. Thanks.
Okay.
I got postcards here for Montgomery County residents. If you haven't signed them, please come over here.
Okay. Thank you all once again. Thank you to our guests for coming. Take care. You are.